Today's watercolour lesson is how to paint a silhouette of a bird on a teasel. Let's get the brushes wet and let's get started. The paper which I'm using today is Bockingford. It's a 140-pound cold press paper and this is glued all the way around. So it's called a Bockingford block. Now the idea is that there's a little tiny gap on this side here and very often you get an arrow. I'll show you what I mean, look. Which basically tells you, my arrow's all worn away there, where the gap is on the paper there, okay? So you can slide a palette knife just nice and level all the way around and then take off that sheet of paper once you've done your painting. So it's a really good way of working without having to stretch watercolour paper. And for me anyway, 9 times out of 10, once it's dry, it dries nice and flat, okay? Now all you need is an outline image. I'll provide this one for you as well. And this is a freebie one from Pixabay, okay? So you know where it's come from, by somebody called Diddy Aries. Thank you very much indeed. Once you've got the image printed off, all you need to do is transfer that box onto the paper. Don't worry about the bird or the teasel or anything like that just yet. Okay, we'll do that once all the background's nice and dry. To do that, mark around the outside edge of the paper, like I've done here, look, so the printout that you've got, onto the watercolour surface. You can just see my little mark there. I've got a cross onto the watercolour paper. That now allows me, when I reposition this, to kind of position it exactly as I had it before, when I drew this line out, as you can see underneath there, look. Once you've got the line drawn out, all you then need to do is get some masking tape and then put that all the way around the outside edge of that line. Make sure that the corners rub down on the masking tape, to show you there, look, all the way down, to stop any water or any paint seeping through those little corners there, because it will do. And this tape I'm using today is nearly transparent. You can just about see it shining on the paper there. There you go, look. And it works really, really well. Okay, colour-wise. Let's put that there to protect the paper a minute. I've already started putting a little bit of cadmium orange within one mixing well. But I'm going to go for a triple mix of cadmium orange, burnt sienna, and also alizarin crimson. And I want this to be more of a milky consistency. Think of four different consistencies. That's what I tend to think of. And that's going to be watery, milky, creamy, and, well, thick. Okay, so you've got four consistencies. Okay, let's get this all mixed up ready. So cadmium orange first of all. As I said, I've already put a little bit in there. I want to make up more than I think I'll need because the fact is, when you're applying a background wash on, you very quickly run out of paint. Okay, so always make more than you think you'll need. And then we'll need the cadmium orange, the burnt sienna, and also lamp black. But remember, just a tiny amount of lamp black though. Don't need it too dark. The reason why I'm using this colour is when you look at that reference photograph, you can see in the bottom corners, probably it's about halfway up gradually anyway. Fades out a little bit, doesn't it? So it's a little bit darker down there. The colours don't have to be spot on. So if your colours are not exactly the same as these, don't worry. It's not a problem at all. It's just simply your own interpretation of that photograph. That's it. I know. So now a tiny amount, as I mentioned, not much at all, of lamp black. Or lampus blackus. Oh, no, that's probably too much, Paul. We'll see. Yeah, it's probably too much. I'm going to go back in again with the burnt sienna. Got to get it right. Always wise to try and get your colours right before you apply them to the paper. And always test those colours out as well before you do that. So that's the burnt sienna back in there again. Let's try that one, shall we, on some scrap watercolour paper. So we'll give it a try on this one here. Maybe a touch more burnt sienna. And we'll try that. That's slightly richer, isn't it? A little bit more. Yeah, I think that should do. Brushes, size 18, size 4, size 0. These are all synthetic brushes as well. So we've got a Panart Series 1181 Premium Mop. We've also got another Panart, I've gone Panart today. And this is a Series 1102, size 4. And the same series, size 0. Just give us some ideas of the brushes I'm going to use today. But it doesn't have to be the same size brushes as these though, whatever you've got within your painting kit. So we'll start off with a size 18. Make sure that you've fully wet it. Now this is really wet now. I'm going to apply it straight to the paper. Here we go. And I want to wet this paper thoroughly before I apply those colours. Because you guarantee, as soon as you start putting it on the paper, it will start to dry. Of course it will. Because it starts to dry really quickly. We've got a bit of fluff there. Let's get rid of that. Also, wet it 2 or 3 times, allowing each layer of water to soak into that paper, just for half a minute or so. Now my paper is starting to cockle, starting to bobble, starting to lift in places, but that's only within the middle. And because this tape I'm using, this masking tape, is low tack, it doesn't tear the paper. I'll give you a little tip near the end, so stay tuned, on how to remove that tape without it tearing the paper. Now because my board is on a slight angle, I know that my water will run down to the bottom here. And because of that, I'll end up with a kind of well of water, a run line of water down there which I need to lift off. And I think we're about there. Yeah. Now that's soaked into the paper just about right now. And it's not running down like a waterfall either. Okay, first colour. Here we go. Let's give this one a try, shall we? And we know that was a cadmium orange, the burnt sienna, and the alizarin crimson. But see what I'm going to do, you know. See what I'm going to do. I'm going to turn this upside down. Really? Why are you going to do that? Well, let me show you what I mean, look. Okay. Start off at the bottom of the picture in effect, really, aren't we? I'm going to start to apply the colour there first of all. Right to the very bottom. Okay, so let's work upside down for a change. And the reason why I'm doing this is because I want to make sure that we're going to get a gradated feel on the watercolour wash. So applying this paint very carefully. So it's going down in our mixing well very quickly, isn't it? Applying the paint. Now, as you apply this paint, I want to make sure it's fairly strong towards the top here, or the bottom effectively, isn't it? And gradually, I'm just going to ease this out all the way down now, without going back to that top. By doing so, what you're going to do is lighten that paper, because you're picking up the water on the paper, aren't you, as you're doing this? And because of that, it's getting lighter and lighter all the time. And there we go. That's one gradated wash already applied, as quick as that. Now, the darker colour, we can do the same thing with that one again. And we can start off by adding this in, just the corners to begin with. And this gradually fades out as well, doesn't it, within this background. Slightly darker towards the bottom there. It's not as dark as a reference photograph, I don't want it that dark. And gradually, that's going to come down. We've got to do this while the paper's nice and wet. A little bit there, a little bit there. Just bringing it towards the middle, but leaving a gap in the middle as well. Maybe a touch more in the corners, darken it a fraction more. And because this is mixing with that water that's already on the paper, it's going to lighten as it dries. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to leave this to dry now while I have some lunch. And then I'll come back to you when it's nice and dry. We'll turn it back the right way around, and then we'll add that silhouette over the top. Well, first I'm going to clean up these edges with a little bit of kitchen roll. Now then, place your drawing back over the top with your graphite back paper underneath as well. Okay, shine side down, remember, as you can see here. And also make sure that you've got it all lined up with your little pencil marks around the edge as well. At least that way around, you're not going to get it roughly in the middle again where you started from. Now, I've already started drawing this one out, just off camera to speed the video up a little bit for you. We're using a medium pressure, so not too hard. And the pencil I'm using today is my mechanical pencil. This particular one is one by Faber-Castell, and it's a 0.5 nib. And the pencil lead is 2H. So in other words, it's slightly hard as well. So standard pencil tends to be HB, doesn't it? So this one's a little bit harder. So when there's the H in there, you know it's going to be slightly harder lead. And that's what I'm using for this. So just drawing around the image using medium pressure all the way around for the bird and the teasel as well. And take your time, okay? Now there's many ways of transferring a drawing onto the paper, we know that. So you can use a grid system, you can use freehand, obviously. You can do freehand, then go ahead. Or like me, as you know, you can work with a transfer paper as well. So just simply do it whichever way that you prefer. I think that should just about do. Yeah, I think so anyway. If I missed anything, it doesn't matter. You can always make it up, you can add more in, entirely up to you. So now we've got ourselves an outline image. So I'm going to use a putty eraser. Just take off any surplus pencil that's transferred to my paper, as you can see here. Look, quite a lot there down the side here, isn't there? And you can just see it within the putty there. Look. So it's well worth just going over the top again of your putty eraser. Okay, now very lightly soften down the pencil that you can see. And again, that takes off that residual pencil, that residual graphite from the paper. Otherwise, you'll find it just simply mixed with the paint when you put the paint on. And that is what I'm going to be doing next. Now, we could just use a straightforward black paint, or you can use a three colour system from Scarlet Lake, Ultramarine Blue, Lemon Yellow, or Scarlet Lake, Phthalo Blue and Lemon Yellow for all different types of warm and cool blacks that you can see here. And there's many more combinations out there as well. Have a look to the video, which I've got to the link there for you on mixing blacks. You probably find that quite interesting. And also, we've got these, which are two colours. There you go. I prefer quite a warm colour. So I might go for this Viridian Green and then Alizarin Crimson. Or, as I mentioned, you could just simply use lamp black mixed with Alizarin Crimson or something like that to warm it up. Entirely your choice. Let's move my palette around a little bit more. I'm going to go for the Viridian Green, which is this one just here. Pop that into the palette. I'm going to make this more to a creamy consistency, but I'll probably make a little bit more off camera as well to kind of make sure I've got more than I think I need again. Otherwise, I just simply run out. And then you've got to mix it once again, which is always a bit of a pain, isn't it, when you're mixing paint. Time and time again. Remember, always make more than you think you need. And Alizarin Crimson. And don't do this over the top of your painting like I'm doing, by the way. Because you know what will happen, don't you? I know, you just ruin the painting. You get it all splattered on there. Now, straight away, we've got ourselves a lovely dark colour. Now, let's make a little bit more quickly. Okay, that should be plenty there. And you can see it's quite creamy in there, actually, as you can see. I know, lovely, lovely colour. I'm going to start off with my size 0. So let's dip it in. I'm going to roll it. I'm going to pull it away. I'm going to go a small amount of cleanish tissue, kitchen roll, there you go. Give it a tap or two, anything like that. I'm going to start to paint in the bird. Start from the top and work your way down. So here we go. Make sure you've got the bird in front of you on an iPad, a tablet or mobile phone, a computer screen, anything like that will do. Then zoom into that picture so you can see those shapes within the bird. So load it, roll it, give it a tap, and then start to paint in all those little areas that you can see. Now, we know here it kind of dips down like that. Think about the outline first of all, then fill it in afterwards, okay? Then the back of the neck comes up like that. A few little wiggles and jiggles here and there as well. Tiny, tiny spikes here and there where some of the feathers are stuck up. And then we've got this sort of dips down here. It's all about looking carefully at that reference photograph. And the more you look, the more you see. You really do. So that comes down to there. And then we've got some more little kind of flicks of feathers coming this way as well. So I'm just going to flick them out. And then down the bottom there, flick a few more ones out there as it gets round towards that beak. Now the beak is a bit of a curved shape like this. So very gently go in there first of all, with hardly any paint on that brush. Use the very tip of the brush. Don't press too hard. So that's already started on the outline edge, hasn't it? So I'm going to carry on and work my way around the bird, doing the same thing. And I'll show you about filling it in very shortly, okay? How would you like to learn how to paint realistic looking wildlife in watercolour? We go through a variety of subjects on dogs, cats, insects and even botanical subjects as well. And I'll guide you through this right from the beginning all the way through to the end for those final brushstrokes. Now every month we produce a PDF version, so a typed out version with photographs of that monthly main video. Why don't you pop along to my Patreon channel, which is patreon.com/thedevonartist. Look for the link in the description down below. Join up and let's paint wildlife in watercolour together and let's get them brushes wet. Load it, roll it, and give it a tap. Of course. Now, no. Here we go. Legs. These little tiny legs. Try to keep within those lines as much as you can. And don't make the legs too thick, okay? Now, trying to see where the angle goes down. The angle of this leg is only just visible behind that teasel, isn't it? And that sort of comes down in this line here. Now, I've hardly got any paint on this brush. So that enables me to paint a thinner line, for now anyway. Just work out the angle. Now, if you think about a clock face, bear with me on this, okay? You think about a clock face, think about the angle that this comes down to. So that's pointing down between, I'd say, 5 and 6 o'clock, something like that. So that helps me to remember angles when I'm viewing it on a reference photograph. And that comes down to here, and you can barely see the feet. And kind of hook over. And most of this will just disappear when we add the teasel over the top. And that goes to that side there. As I say, keep it thin to begin with. Have it slimmer than you think it will need to be. And then you can thicken it and widen it as you go along. Only when you're sure you need to do that. And the same with this one here, look. So I'm going to very lightly, with the tip of the brush, bring down a pair of shorts, which I always call them shorts. I know they're not. I call them shorts. From the shorts all the way down to the foot. Nice and slim. And maybe a little bit wider there now. Now I know I've been cautious, I've been careful not to go too thick on those legs. Then bringing it down to the claw. Down to there. I'm going to get a little bit of paint on the tip of my brush here. Just so I can darken this area down a fraction. And then I can then fill in the rest of this foot here. Look. Small amount of paint. I'm not always tapping this brush. As you know, I like to load it, roll it and tap it. Sometimes I don't. Sometimes I want a little bit more paint left on that brush. And you tend to get to know that through time, you know, through practice more than anything. Okay, and that goes probably about there now. Very careful now. And there we go. Now, filling the bird in. I'm going to wash this brush out a minute. Always keep washing them brushes out. Remember that, because if you don't, what will happen? It will start to harden on the bristles of the brush. And when that happens, then it will get into the metal ferrule. And your bristles very often go like that. Now, here we go. Let's fill it in. So simply, with a larger brush, fill in the hole in the middle. And once this is dry, you very often find little light spots, which you think, oh yeah, I've missed a bit there. And you can fill those in once it's nice and bone dry. And then all I need to do is the same technique, the same thing on the teasel itself, then we'll have ourselves a finished painting. Okay, so let's do the teasel next, shall we? Now, when you're working with your size 0 brush or whatever size you're using, as long as it's got a decent tip on it, you have to consider the pressure that you're applying to the paper. Obviously, you've got to consider, as I mentioned, about how much you load that brush, too much paint on there, and your lines will be far too thick. So remember to load it, roll it, and tap it before you go to the painting. And then consider the amount of pressure that you're going to put on those bristles. So if you put too much pressure on, again, you'll end up with a thicker line. So initially, be very tentative with it. And what I mean by that is only barely touch the paper with the tip of that brush. And by doing so, your line will stay thinner. So don't overload the brush, as I mentioned. Make sure you tap some paint off. Then use a very light hand to apply these lines. Look at the angles that these lines go as well. They go in a variety of different angles, don't they? Think about that clock face I mentioned earlier on as well. So which way are those lines pointing? Are they pointing to 3 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 7 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock? I don't know. Have a look around and look at the angles that you've got there. Take your time. There's no rush trying to get a painting finished. You should never ever rush a painting. And most of all, enjoy the process. Now another thing as well, how do you hold your brush? Do you hold it further up the handle or do you hold it closer to that metal ferrule? I find by holding the brush closer to the ferrule, or even on the ferrule sometimes, I get a much finer, tighter line. So it kind of tightens your hand up a little bit. If you want a freer flowing brush, if you know what I mean, then you'd hold the brush further up that handle. So remember that when you're working with it, because if you find that you can't maintain those fine lines, try holding that brush further down the handle, quite close to that metal ferrule. Right, let's get this teasel painted, shall we? So stay with me and I'll be back in a minute when I show you another technique about how to paint tapered lines. I'll show you that very shortly.
I'm just working my way down now. Got all these sections to do. Now when you work on these areas here, notice how they actually get thinner and slimmer as you go along. So I'm going to apply the pressure first like this. Then ease off the pressure as I come around to get a nice tapered line. All these marks, by the way, I'll start from the inside and then flick out. That way around, you get a tapered line that way as well. Because when you first apply your brush to some paper, get some more scrap paper from testing, You start off very often with a dot, don't you? And then you can flick away like that. But you don't want to start off with that dot on the outside edge of the teasel, do you? So always remember to start from the inside and then flick out from that point. Now then, the rest of these areas depends on whether you're left or right-handed. So I'm going to turn it around this way. So I get the natural curve of my hand, okay? So all we've got to do is start from this side here and then gradually lift off again to get a tapered edge like that. Got the idea? So think about the natural curve. Try to ghost it first of all if you're not sure if you're going to get it in the right place. And then simply go for it. Okay, here we go. Let's try this area here now. Quite a long one coming around here. Now I'm going to have to probably do this in two strikes, I think, because of the angle it's at. So I'm going to go in first with a fine line like this, then taper it away as it comes towards the top. Then I need to thicken that. And what I mean by that is literally going in again with a slightly heavier hand or even slightly fuller brush and thicken that line down and then thin it out as you come back towards the top of that line. If you want to make it neater, what you can do, make sure you're not putting your hand on wet paint, by the way. Believe me, I've done it many times. Just neaten it out around the curve there to make it nice and curved like that. And then bring it all the way around, like so, getting there. It's going to be thicker the closer it gets to the main body of the teasel. Then we've got to do the same with the rest of those as well, okay? Remember that curvature of your wrist. Remember this kind of action as you're working with it. And if you're not sure if anything's dry or not, get some scrap paper and cover over an area that might still be a little bit damp in places. I don't think it is though, I think we're okay with that area there. Let's do the rest of these now on this side. And then do the same with the stem, okay? So bring your lines down the inside of the line like that. It doesn't matter if it's slightly wobbly either on this side, does it? Really doesn't, not on the stem. So I'm applying more paint this time. Now. And I think the stem just slightly goes to the right a little bit on that reference photograph like that. So I'm just going to slightly widen it there, look. And the same on the other side. So I'm just going to just make sure I fill this area in here first of all. Okay, get some more paint, and we'll try bringing that line down the same way. Keep running out of paint there. I'm not loading, rolling, and tapping at the moment because I don't need a fine tip on my brush. I will be doing when that tip is needed. You can see the benefit through synthetic brushes as well is that you get the spring back rate or the snap back as well very often. In other words, what it means is as that bristle comes away on the paper, it reforms its shape again straight away. So it goes nice and flat like that and goes right to a point back again straight after. And that's one of the reasons why I like synthetic brushes. And these particular brushes by Panhard are quite good as well. I'm not paid by them or anything like that, so don't worry. But they are very good brushes, actually, I do agree. Especially their synthetic range. Okay, so I'm going to start to bring out a few little spikes here and there. From different angles, barely touching. Load it, roll it, tap it now. Remember to keep washing that brush out as well. You know how important that is to preserve those bristles a bit more. Don't ruin that brush. And bring out these little tiny marks to add to the overall effect on the stem. The same on the other side. Vary the length, vary the thickness of these little spikes as well. And then I'm going to wash that brush out. So with a clean brush, I'm going to go back into my paint again and just add in some of these little tiny marks we can see coming off these areas here. Tiny, tiny marks, barely discernible, but they are there. We can just about see them, can't we? So a few here and there to kind of break up that edge. So back to the size 4, and it's time to fill in the teasel. Take your time, don't bring it all the way to the edge though when you do this. Think about where the light's coming through. And we can see the light coming through around this sort of angle here, isn't it? Around there, look. And that's what I'm looking at. I want to make sure that's what these lines showing. I'm going to put some additional lines in around here. You can use this brush as well. It's got a reasonable tip on it. Not as good as my size 2 though. And do that all the way around. And once you've got this kind of area filled in, you can then tidy up that edge just by using tiny marks. This is also where you realise you haven't got enough paint. I don't run out of paint, I haven't got enough to kind of fill this section in. So I always say, make more than you think you'll need. Oh dear. I think I might just have enough to go around. Okay, back to the size 2, and I'm going to start to bring out some very light marks now around the edge of this to break up this very edge. Looks too round, doesn't it? Looks like it's just been placed there. So flick up around the edge of this kind of dome we've just made in there, this big mass of dark. So flick it around like so. Blend it into the edge of the teasel there. And when you're working around these edges, do the same as we've done before. Start from the inside and then pull away towards the outside to get that tapered line, remember. But try and break it up as you work your way around the edge of the teasel. So what you're trying to avoid really is that big oval shape in the middle. So take your time and try to get it right. And it doesn't have to be perfect, okay? Then once you've done all that, have a check around, make sure there's no little white dots kind of appearing within the dried black areas. If you remember, I said that earlier on, that sometimes when it dries, you get some very little white dots appearing here and there. And also areas where that black paint hasn't quite covered enough. And that may be because when you go into your black paint after washing that brush out, very often there's water residue within the metal ferrule of that brush. Then that will then drip into the paint and dilute it as well. Obviously thinning that paint down. So it's worth remembering that. So that's the masking tape taken off. I've signed it as well with my permanent pen. This, by the way, is a uni pin final liner I use, and it's a size 003. So very, very tiny, as you can see there. Now, just bear in mind, if you decide to show your paintings, your watercolour paintings, with an art exhibition or gallery anywhere, it's always wise just to sign it with a pencil instead, rather than with a pen. So it depends on what you want to do with the painting afterwards. Now, how would you like to learn some more fun, easy painting techniques? Have a look to the video to the top right. I'll see you there.